All right. Good morning once again, and welcome back to Urban Today. My name is Henry Sekanjako, and I've been joined by Anthony Womali, who is the lead counsel or legal counsel, the National Unity Platform. We're going to be talking about the continued clash between the police and the Electoral Commission. You all understand that on 9th November, different presidential candidates started their campaigns. But we've seen that the opposition, especially presidential candidates, have been clashing with the police over COVID-19 guidelines. They say that this particular group has not respected the regulations as set by the EC and the Minister of Health. And we want to understand why this is happening. Good morning, Anthony.
Good morning, how are you?
Welcome to Urban Today.
Thank you.
Why are people not respecting the SOPs as advised by the Minister of Health and the Electoral Commission?
Well, I believe as National Unity Platform and our presidential candidate is doing his best. He has done his best to comply with the guidelines. He has ensured that they are complied with, whether or not they amount to flouting the electoral or the campaign process is a whole different aspect to discuss, but I think he's doing his best, just like all the other candidates across the board.
But EC would tell you, or police would tell you that, okay, you're saying you're respecting them, but we're seeing processions, we're seeing mass rallies, and it's one of the guidelines that EC says that you, as a presidential candidate, when you're holding campaigns, you shouldn't go beyond 200 people, but we have seen, most of your rallies, more than 200 people, people holding processions, and maybe that's the reason they're saying that you're violating, flouting these particular guidelines that are put.
I think we need to begin from the beginning. Okay. We need to begin from the beginning that, well, when the roadmap came out and the campaign program came out for the presidential candidates, it was clear, according to the EC, that the candidates were supposed to access their venues to begin with, to do their campaigns and to talk to the 200 people.
Okay.
But particularly for Robert Kyagulanyi Ssentamu, our presidential candidate, it has not even been possible for him to access the venue. So it, from that point, it turns out to be a battle or a fight between his supporters and the police, or himself and the police. So he hasn't actually effectively accessed the venues to even ensure that the 200 people are there.
Mm-hmm.
So once he's blocked and maybe diverted to the villages, to the other routes, at the end of the day, everyone gets excited and people begin following him, and hence what we are seeing. But then number two, that is not only on him. That's even on President Museveni. So it's obvious that the guidelines probably are not even enforceable, they're not even practical. You cannot say you're going to campaign and across the country and then you restrict someone in such a measure, and after that you only look at some few individuals while leaving out the others.
There's been a fight over venues. You say, okay, for us we're supposed to be in this particular venue, then police comes out to say that no, you're supposed to be at point B. Who picks these venues that where you hold your campaigns from?
First of all, like I told you, this is the bias that the security agencies or the government agencies have had against opposition or non-government candidates. The venues, first of all, are paid for by the candidates.
Okay.
They are booked prior by candidates, and it has always been the duty of the police to make sure that they do not allow us to go to the venues we have acquired or we have booked, not only during this campaign, but even before when we try to do consultations. You know, we would hire premises and police would go behind the back and tell people to return our money or to not even allow us onto the venues. So, and then number two, the police chooses to direct you where to go through if you want to go to a particular venue. And I think that's also not proper, because at the end of the day, we have calculated our movements according to how we want to approach. You know, we can only be in about three districts in a day and you only have about 2 or 3 hours in a particular district. So the police will tell you this is not, you wonder why the police chooses the venue for you, yet you have paid for it and then you have organized accordingly.
Let's talk about the challenges that you have faced. You know, you hit the road on 9th November. Share with us, what are some of the challenges that you've experienced as a National Unity Platform? Has the level been, leveled enough, the ground leveled enough for you?
No, not at all.
Yeah.
First of all, we had only about 60-something days, so every day mattered a lot. And through the times the police blocked us, we have not had time to address the issues that we want to address before the people. Mr. Kyagulanyi has not had time to even sleep.
Okay.
Over about 5 times he has slept in his car. He has not had time to rest. He has not had time to even meet with us as the team to prepare for the next venue. So the blockings, the diversions, mm-hmm. the stoppages, the arrests, and illegal detentions, because he was illegally detained in Nalufenya, reasons being, one, he was never allowed access to his lawyers, family, and friends, and number two, he was brought to court way above the 48 hours, and that's, mm-hmm. I think that's what you're going to discuss on Friday the 18th, when he's supposed to go back to court. Okay. But as a party, we have had those blockages, and as a legal team, we have also had strains, because it's normally him in the news, but after him, the young boys and girls, the supporters, the fans, the people that are working for him have been arrested. And I think we have over 800 people, members of National Interpol from behind the bars, mm-hmm. in different prisons and police stations all over the country. Mm-hmm. So it has been straining, it has been engaging, and some of the party officials are not presidential candidates, but also parliamentary and other position candidates. So we've been up and about it. We should also be on the campaign.
There's also rumors that you've been denied access to radio.
Yes, radio stations have.
Is that true?
Yes, it is. Mm. Very true, very true. Especially in Hoima, okay. and other areas, even in Kabong or Kotido. Mm. Every when you want to, you see, after you wind up with the rally, okay. You should be able to go to a radio station and address the general public about your program. And the police has either blocked him or has forced him out of the radio stations or has asked the radio stations not to allow him. And there are some of those not very direct but indirect blockages, mm-hmm. where the police and security agencies, especially the RDCs, will go and tell the radio stations that do not dare host these people. And because of fear of losing business, they will heed.
Do you pay for these shows?
Definitely. No one will give you a free show. Mm-hmm. I don't think Urban TV will give Chagwenye a free show, mm-hmm. for about 30 minutes. They will definitely charge him highly. Mm-hmm. And it's so hurting that you pay the money and then you can't access the radio, and then they call it a scientific campaign.
Mm. And then that brings me to the question on whether you think the Electoral Commission, who are the managers of this particular election, do you think they're in charge of this process?
Definitely not. They are not. For example, you will see Justice Sibiya Bakama. Mm. He will tell you when Chagwenye was arrested, he doesn't watch news, he didn't know. Then later he summons him and says, you're floating the guidelines. I don't know whether he now picked interest in watching news after. But generally speaking, I do not think they are in control. Candidates have been harassed. Candidates are sleeping on the roadside. Candidates are not being allowed to access venues. Candidates are starving alongside the road trying to campaign, but they're not doing anything. And then, two, candidates have been seen floating SOPs like, mm-hmm. President Museveni and his group, mm-hmm. and they've not done anything about it. So I do not think they are really completely in control. But to begin with, even before the campaign trail was, before we started the campaigns, you know that the Electoral Commission met the president, and we raised noise about that. And they said, no, we met him because he's a minister of finance, we needed money. Then number two, we met him because we knew after him we'll meet all the other political parties. I do not think that happened. Mm-hmm. So I do not think they are independent, at least by way we see things now.
Sure. And have you tried to engage the Electoral Commission? Because contestants, you're supposed to engage them on things that you think are not going on well. Have you tried to engage them, the EC boss, Mr. Byamu, can tell him that, look here, this is happening to us?
Yes, we have. Mm-hmm. You remember that even before the campaigns, during the consultations, when they stopped Chagulani from consulting in Chadonda and then Northern Uganda, we went to him. Then even when they stopped him, when they blocked him, we went and still insisted that some things should be done the right way. And they keep the old rhetoric. We are going to do this, we are going to do our best, police should do this. And you see these meetings, actually the problem with this campaign is the security agencies. Mm-hmm. That is where the problem lies. Mm-hmm. It's not about the SOPs. Imagine if they said Chagulani is going to go to, he's supposed to come to Namisindwa district on, mm-hmm. the 6th, yeah. of December, of January. Mm-hmm. We have booked a venue which is an enclosed field where only a few people can be allowed in. But I can assure you, if police allows us to access that venue, mm-hmm. we can have 200 people. And at the end of the day, it's also not very practical that someone will move to a venue without someone standing at the roadside to wave at them. That's very normal and that is a given. Mm-hmm. But police doesn't want to see that on the side of Chagulanyi or Amuriat, but they would rather see it on the side of President Museveni like it was in Imbarara. So I think the security agencies are the ones that are disturbing. Even if you complain to Mr. Byabakama, he will keep promising you that things are going to be better, but that will be all of it.
Talking about negotiations, your candidate, Robert Chagulanyi Sentamu, was yesterday summoned by Electoral Commission to talk about things that you're talking about here, security blocking him and all that. But he was a no-show.
No, he showed up through agents. You see, with the elections, that's why if at nomination, you go with the nominator and the seconder. You also go with an official agent, someone who will work for you, because he's traversing the whole country. He's in northern Uganda. He has not even returned home ever since he hit the campaign trail. So it's very normal for you to send a representative, just like all these summonings ever since the campaigns started. Have you ever seen President Museveni at the EC? He has never been there, but has been sending agents. So he showed up. He showed up through the agents of the party and the agents that he personally appointed to represent him. And number two, you know that he's going to show up today because we agreed with the EC that he shows up today and any other concerns will be raised then.
So you're not able to agree on certain things yesterday. The reason he's coming is being invited today?
Yes, because remember yesterday as agents, we also had agents of the party, but also agents, his personal agents. But now he has felt the heat himself, the things that probably he will tell the EC as an individual, and we hope that those issues will be addressed at the presidential level, because he also has concerns against other presidential candidates, including President Museveni, that probably when they are put across the board, we shall also have President Museveni summoned to the EC, and then we shall pick it up from
there. What are those concerns that you want to speak to the EC boss?
The discriminatory conduct of the police and security agencies, the illegal arrests, the illegal detentions, blockages, denial of access to radio stations, and then paying a blind eye on the president and the other people who are actually having mass rallies are not being affected or summoned by the EC. And remember, the Supreme Court had instructed that the campaigns, when someone is a president, he should not be given unfair advantage over the other candidates. And those are the recommendations that should be implemented now, including implementation by EC.
Okay, let's talk about a free and fair election. Last week, the Electoral Commission received ballot papers, presidential and then women MP, election ballot papers. But they say that NUP, among other opposition parties, were invited, but you didn't show up to receive these ballot papers. How do you complain of a
petitions? They begin to put up party structures. They begin to, first of all, the EC said whoever wants to be part of the process can now book their own tickets and then travel to wherever, to UK, to UAE, now then they say now the ballot papers have come, please come and inspect them. I think whether someone went there or not, we have not cried foul about the ballot papers yet, because for us I think that is a far way in the
but
corner.
I think the process starts with ballot papers and everything.
Yes, but there are more serious issues. There are more serious issues to be handled. For example, those were ballot papers for women members of parliament, and we have so many women that are probably left out of those ballot papers, actually discriminatory, because they have been written off by the EC. We have complaints at the EC, and some of the times we have appeared before the EC on behalf of these woman member of parliament candidates. It is very obvious that the EC is hell bent on not including them on the ballot papers. But as for National Unity Platform, I think for us the inspection of the ballot papers was not so paramount, much as it's important, but we had more pressing issues like the president sleeping at the roadside, not being able to access the venues, and his people being arrested left, right, and center, and some actually being killed.
Right. As we wrap up, Anthony, I want us to talk about the districts that you have missed. How many are they in number?
There are quite many. There are quite many, but we have revised the roadmap, and we are going to visit all those districts. The new roadmap is out, the new program is out, and every district that we missed out is going to be revisited, including districts like Tororo and I think Sironko and all the other districts in Western Uganda. The map is out, only that it's going to be a tedious process, but we are going to revisit them.
Okay. And then briefly, as we sign out, should we expect your president at EC today? And
yes,
what time is that going to
be? If in economics we used to say ceteris paribus, if all facts remain constant, we should be seeing him anytime from 9 a.m. And we hope we shall have something positive towards a free and fair election.
And after that, he's hitting the campaign trail again?
Yes, definitely. He's going to hit the campaign trail and move, because he doesn't even have any days to spare.
All right. Thank you very much, Anthony, for sparing time for us and then joining us on Urban today. That's all we had time for. And as you go for those campaign rallies, make sure that you observe a social distance. The SOP is that because COVID is real, apparently we have about 27,000 cases. So you need to, you know, to be aware that COVID is real, and then protect yourself and your loved ones from this pandemic. We'll catch you again tomorrow at the same time, same station. Be sure to join us again tomorrow. And from the rest of the team, it's a good morning and bye-bye for now.